That's life.
That's life.
That's what all the people say. You're riding high in April, shot down in May. But I know I'm gonna change that tune. When I'm back on top in June. I said that's life.
That's life.
And as funny as it may seem, some people get their kicks stomping on a dream. But I don't let it get me down. 'Cause this fine old world, it keeps spinning around.
Hi, I'm John Solari, your host of The Method Actor Speaks. And today we have a special guest who, by popular demand, the crew, especially the crew here, and myself, was so honored. And God, they have Edie Williams back, the real movie star. Edie, I got to tell you, that dress you're wearing is incredibly beautiful. And it makes you look so sexy.
Thank you, John. You're sexy, too. You know, I wore it for you because this is the gown I wore it to the Oscars.
Really?
And every year I come up with something that's going to really captivate the paparazzi, and they like this. So they said, oh, the blue. So, and you have these beautiful blue eyes, so I wore the dress to match your eyes, John.
Well, that is incredible, and I can understand why the paparazzi
Which part of the dress you like the best, the rhinestones or the belt?
Well, you go from the rhinestones to the belt in between. I mean, it's just, that is a dress. I mean, it's beautiful.
Thank you.
So are you. Before we really get into talking about you, Edie Williams, I mean, I'm so glad you came back because you are a legend. And I mean, people could look you up on Google you, Edie Williams.
Google me.
Yeah,
they can Amazon me and Google
Amazon,
me. And
all the movies you've been in.
Yes, they sell all my things on eBay and Google. How come they get to do that without me? They don't ask me.
Really?
And then it's amazing because films that you have forgotten that you have done.
Yeah.
You look at that, and there they are. They're back. You know, people can have them now and see them.
Yeah, and well, for you too. And then the Beyond the Valley of Dolls is coming out on DVD.
Mm-hmm.
So by the time the show airs, it'll be out. Now, we're going to play a tape, and then we're going to really talk. You brought some clips that I'm really...
I brought you a clip from a film that Martin Mull produced. It's called Rented Lips. It's me and Robert Downey Jr., and it's a comedy, and it's so cute. And they had me sing like Marlene Dietrich, and I wore a tuxedo, and I wore my hair like hers, and I'm bright red lips, and a cigarette holder. And
well, let's watch it, and then we'll really talk about it. So whenever the crew in there, John is going to play it for us.
It's Halloween, my heir. It's time to spook and scare. It's time to dress up like a woman if you dare. It's time for fishnet hose and next to nothing clothes. It's time to be the kind of person that you always were afraid that you might be. Boys and girls are playing like tag and other stuff, but grown-ups sometimes too are blind and fight like dogs and catsies. Oh, how could little German kinder grow up to be Nazis?
Happy Halloween, sister. I have big news from Treasure.
Please, come in, sailor.
Thank you.
Place with happy dads and moms, and then the awful Lufthansa started dropping bombs.
Heather, Lufthansa is a modern commercial airline. Make it Luftwaffe.
Well, how was it up to there?
Oh, it's on film. It's film.
And we're back. That was great. Now, you shot it that at the Bonanza Ranch? Bonanza is a television series.
And that director was Robert Downey Jr.'s father, Robert Downey, and he also directed Putney Swope, was what made him famous.
Yeah, right.
And then he got this, and they called me and they asked me if they had another actress to do it the day before the film started. And they said, could you start our film tomorrow? And they told me, you know, basically what it was. And they said, we really want somebody that will be able to get along with Dick Shawn because he was feuding with the other actress. And I said, absolutely, I'm on my way, I'm coming, here I am. And so I showed up and I thought, okay, I haven't met Dick Shawn yet. How am I gonna do this, you know? How can I get this going, get this film together? And so I said, Dick, I said, how would you like to direct me in my scenes? You could be my director. And he says, oh, baby, I'd like that, hon. Let's do that. And so then they all asked me, they said, how did you do that? You know, Dick Shawn, he's so happy. I said, well, I said he could direct me in my scenes. And they go, oh, okay. So there were like two directors in the movie. But it worked out well.
Yeah.
You know, we all had fun, and he had fun, and he added a few more scenes in the movie that he wrote, and I loved him.
Yeah, he was a good actor.
Yeah.
Died on stage.
Well, we lost him, but he's infamous in the movie. He's still here. We can.
Now, this was a takeoff on The Producers, right? This
movie. Yeah, it is.
Because he was great in that. He stole that movie when he came on stage. And
they're all wearing their German outfits, dressed like Nazis. And they've played it on television a lot.
A lot.
They like this movie.
What's the name of it again, so the audience?
It's called The Rented Lips.
The Rented Lips. Here's My Lips. What a great title. Mm.
And the other film that I brought you, it's called Girl from Mars, Bad Girl from Mars. And I played Emmanuel, and that has picked up, like, people want that video, and they want it, and want it, and want it, and it's got some really funny scenes.
Do we have a clip of that here? Today?
Yeah. Oh, it's another spoof on movies, making movies.
No, we don't have it. Unfortunately, they don't have it today.
Well, it's a little hot. No. So it's R-rated, but it's pretty spunky, spicy.
Oh.
Just in this day and age when they have naughty television, I think it's okay.
Yeah, what was naughty back then is network today, probably.
No,
just really,
things are changing so quickly. We have to, you know, run to keep up with everything. We're in the space age.
Well, you live in Century City, right?
Yes, I wanted to tell you, you know, I went to 20th Century Fox, where I was there for 7 years, and that's on Avenue of the Stars, and now that's where I live, right? Off of Avenue of the Stars is Galaxy Way, and they have a beautiful Mediterranean building with condos in there behind a big security guard gate and fountains and gorgeous, lavish, you know, flowers everywhere, and you can have two dogs there. And I'm working with Century Platinum 21 Real Estate Company. They're in Beverly Hills on Cannon Drive. And, you know, we sell some of those condos in there to people from China and people from Persia. And they like the privacy that you have to go through a guard gate with an appointment to get in.
Oh.
It's aha.
Uh-huh.
I've got those autograph collectors now. It's like you can't grab me from them. They take photographs of me from magazines that I was in from like 20 years ago.
Right.
Pinup pictures. And they're always asking me to sign these pictures that, you know, I'm a mature woman.
I saw
woman
some of them
now.
On when I went, when I looked up your name. Especially on what was Edie Williams, and the other one was Edie Williams Events, and I saw all these great pictures of you. I mean,
Edie Williams Events, you can do the whole new thing now is doing blogging.
Right, that's what you want to talk
blogging,
about.
You write your own little story of something eventful that's happened in the last week that you think is exciting and interesting to the world. And I wrote an article about you. It's like the afternoon is going to be spent with the fabulous John Solari, and we're going to talk about everything and anything and drive people crazy and have them laugh and giggle. And so I wrote an article about you, and it's called Blogging, and everybody can do it on their computer. And
well, there
people,
it is right there.
People can send in their comments. And they just have to punch in their email address, and they send in their comments, and you can have a little, you know, rendezvous through your
That's
computer.
That's on the one Events, Edie Williams Events.
Yeah, Edie Williams Events.
Let's go. I want to go back to when you were doing that film. You know, you said it was cold. You were working up there. What was it
like?
Oh,
it was 40 degrees, and we were working. They wanted to hurry up and get it finished as fast as they could. We were working Monday through Saturdays, and I had a limousine out there just to stay warm, and I'd sit in the back seat of the limousine and cuddle up in there.
By yourself?
Until they needed me.
It's all for you.
Basically, you know, you are. The crew did say, you know, I said, I got to get all the way back to my place, take care of my dog. And they said, well, why don't you stay here for the night in your dressing trailer? And I said, I don't think so. Isn't there somebody that will drive me back? So I started, you know, having the limo come out and pick me up. And then I asked the limo to stay there in the freezing weather and keep me warm, which they did. And people would pile in. The makeup lady would come in.
Now this, I can't take my eyes off this dress here. Now, was this made especially for you? Or?
The dress I designed.
You designed.
Because I wanted a color that nobody else would have, and I wanted something dazzling. And I added the rhinestones to it, and I found the earrings to match the dress, and the silver buckle belt, and when I walked in to the arrivals at the Beverly Hills Hotel for the Oscars, the photographers, they went crazy. They loved it. It was, you know, Edie, look here, Edie, here, you know, click, 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 click. And it's like, you know, you want to make a grand entrance, like Mae West, or, you know, do it up big if you're going to go, you know, stand
out. You've been doing
out.
That for how many years? I mean, you're really well known for that, for going to the Oscars.
Yeah, I've been going to the Oscars since... You know, Bob Hope was there as the MC, and I would arrive with a Great Dane one year, and the next year I would arrive carrying a little bunny rabbit, and I'd be all dressed in yellow for springtime. And the next year I arrived in a long red gown and a red cape, and I took a leopard with me, you know. And then as it became more flamboyant, more well-known, people were more tuning into the Oscars, more security arrived. And then they started closing down the street the day of the Oscars. And then they started, the last time I remember that you had to pass through, like at the airport, you know, this
metal detector.
Really? And they opened up my purse, and they, you know, I always wanted to bring a little mascot with me, so I brought this little bunny rabbit, and they opened up my purse, and they went, what's that? And I said, well, that's my little rabbit, Bobby, you know, he goes with me everywhere, and like, because I want him in the picture,
yeah,
you know.
Really?
You know, help preserve, you know, the world. And did you see on the front page of the Los Angeles Times today was a huge picture of the dolphins. They've just declared all the sea around Hawaii is a
great, isn't it?
Memorial to the fish, that they're preserved and they're safe.
Yeah,
and
like, Bush signed it today because of Jacques Cousteau's son. He did a film on it. And actually, I remember, I always watched Jacques Cousteau movies years ago. And this was a movie that his son had done about the reefs out there, saving the reefs, and the president was inspired by that.
I'm a huge nature lover. Staying close to nature, I think it keeps you young, it keeps you healthy. Just yesterday, I took my horse out hiking. Yeah. I was hiking up on a mountain in Malibu with my big thoroughbred yesterday. Yeah. And then this morning, I was out jogging with my Labrador. We jogged all around Century City. And it's gorgeous. The air is beautiful because they've saved the huge trees. It's the back lot of 20th Century Fox.
Is that what it is?
They've saved it. They
preserved
it. With the place where I live is like, it has 14 acres of park area that they've saved. It's beautiful.
You wrote something about the horses. You know, the horse that was hurt, and I saw something you wrote about it, about a three-year-old, the legs.
Yeah, I wrote about Barbaro because he created a lot of compassion that I think sort of had dropped down to a low level in our world when he hurt his leg in that Preakness race.
Right.
And they have a website for Barbaro, and you can send in a message to him. And I've sent three messages in to him that I have a lot of faith that he, as young as he is, a three-year-old racehorse, that he's still growing taller, and his muscles are still, his bones are still developing, and I think that the plate that they had to put in his leg is going to grow into his bone structure, and I think he's going to really establish a lot of helpful encouragement for people that have been in car accidents, and they don't have to lose a limb. They can have a new brace put in there like Barbaro had done by five yeah. doctors that operated on him. They want to save him because he's such a fantastic, you know, beautiful, magnificent horse. And by them saving this horse and people following the story, it's shown, it's like he's resurrected the rebirth of compassion in the world. Let's have more compassion. Let's have more caring. Let's save, you know, valuable racehorse. Let's save the dolphins in Hawaii. Let's save our bald eagles. Let's save, you know, our wonderful creatures that we have. There's only 1,000 cheetahs left, for example, in the world. And now they have a film out called Dumas that I saw recently, one of the most beautiful, heartwarming films I've seen in a long time, about a cheetah cub. And they raise him, and they teach him how to live with people, and then they take him back to where they found him in Africa, and they set him free so that he can live among the other cheetahs. And
only 1,000 left? I mean,
we've got to start doing what we can to preserve our beauty in the world like that.
Man keeps moving and moving and moving and building and building and pushing the animals out, which is a shame. You know, when you look at the woods, somebody says, oh, I like to live there. Before you know it, there goes all the animals that live there because some asshole wants to live on a mountain.
You know, really. Funny, John.
I mean, that's the bottom line. That's the way I feel about it. They destroy everything around it because they want to live up there, and all the animals are gone. Or they come down and they got to be killed. You
know? Well, just like the polar bear that was, it was some kind of a brown bear that was in somebody's swimming pool.
Yeah.
They don't have any place left to go. It's like, where are we going to go? We need more parks. We've got to save our parks.
They're always shooting them. They kill them. You know, you get some
tranquilizer guns, John.
I mean, but some of them, they kill them too. You know, they want to be hunters at heart.
That's why I live in between two golf courses. I live in between Hillcrest Country Club and Los Angeles Country Club. And you get all that beautiful green, fresh oxygen air. It filters through, and I open up the windows
of my place.
You
ever get any golf balls coming in the windows? No.
So I live between two golf courses in that Century City, and you got to come and visit me. I'll give you a ride home.
Okay. And what I was also thinking, you know, because now, some of the other films that you've done that you're really proud of, do you want to talk about some of them?
Oh, yes. I did a film with Robert Mitchum called Jake's Banner. Actually, it was a television series. I was so thrilled to meet Robert Mitchum. And he's exactly the same way, on screen, off screen, the same guy. You know,
that's
he's
what
not
I heard,
any
yeah.
different. He doesn't do anything different. And now, Robert Downey's always doing something different. He's coming home, walking into the wrong house. And I love doing that film with Robert because he was really nice to me. He came into my dressing room and he looked at my pictures and my book. And yeah, I've worked with, you know, Burt Reynolds on Smokey and the Bandit 2. And he came to see me at my place and we became friends. And I worked with the famous writer George Axelrod that wrote Breakfast at Tiffany's. And
what did you do with him?
Worked with Walter Matthau. We made a film called The Secret Life of an American Wife. And he just said, we'll make her a Marilyn Monroe blonde. And one day my hair was all blonde, which, you know, I was willing to do it. And I've worked with, you know, a lot of David Janssen. I loved him, you know. And he liked his scotch. I worked with Richard Pryor. We became best friends. I had a romance with Richard for a while. He was adorable, so funny and cute and darling. And I'd say, Richard, isn't there anything you're afraid of in the whole world? And he says, yes, if I can't pay the rent.
Really?
Really?
Well, yeah, I can understand that. That's especially in this kind of business. One day you're there and next day you're not.
And then right when I was dating him, he got a call to make Blazing Saddles with Gene Wilder for like $5 million. And when I was dating Mr. October, Reggie Jackson, he became Mr. October. And I've become to the conclusion, John, that I have this big electric current running through me. and that whoever I'm with, if I put my hand on your knee or something, it's going to ignite you, and you're going to become electrified, and...
You put your hand on my knee, you got something else becomes electrified.
Well, that's the idea. Huh? I mean, look what's happening in the world. They're building up Las Vegas, like, so fast, we can hardly keep up with it. There's a new hotel there, a new hotel there, and it's like...
Do you go to Vegas?
Oh, I go there all the time.
Really?
I love that because it's like a fantasy. If you can't get to Italy, go to the Venetian and get in the canoe and go on their ride on their canal. And you can go up during the week, and it's very reasonable. And, you know, if you can't get to Paris, go stay at the Hotel Paris, you know.
New York.
If you can't get to Hawaii, go to the Mirage Hotel, pretend you're in Hawaii.
God.
It's only, what, a half-hour flight from Los Angeles.
Yeah. I have a friend, Gene Kilroy, works there. I don't know what hotel. He's been there for like over 30 years. And he keeps...
Well, call him up and tell him we're coming. I want a suite.
I never know what hotel he's going to be in. He's one of the people you go see when you want to stay at a hotel.
Oh.
You know, he's like that. Gene knows. He was with Muhammad Ali for like 20 years.
That's another fellow that I got to meet. We were on the same plane together when we got off the plane. And he said, do you want to carry my briefcase for me? And I said, I'd love it. And as soon as all the kids spotted him, they just followed him, an entourage of, you know, a group of kids following him. And he was signing his autographs away. And we became really good friends. He gave me a ride home in his limousine.
You are a real movie star, though. You know, I mean, there's not too many people
Thank
left
you.
Like you.
I've had a lot of romances, too. I've had a lot of famous lover boys from a president of the country, Miguel Alemán of Mexico, who they named a boulevard after in Mexico. We were great friends. He'd come to see me, and I saw him in Acapulco. And I've been great, close, best friends with Carlo Ponte when he was separated from Sofia, and we, you know, got to know each other, and that was exciting and interesting.
That must have been interesting. Carlo Ponte was... Yeah. Sophie Loren. Did you ever get to meet Sophie Loren?
No, I wasn't too interested in meeting her, but I liked Carlo.
See,
he'd have his son drive him to my house, and he'd come and stay with me. And Dino Martin Jr., and I dated first, and then afterward, you know, he went off with Dorothy Hamill, and then I was with his father a lot. The big guy, Dean Martin.
Dean Martin.
He taught me a lot. We spent a lot of time at his restaurant, La Familia. Yeah. And that was exciting. He was very amusing. He loved to watch baseball.
He was very quiet, wasn't he? He wasn't...
Yeah, he was. He liked you to do all the talking. Yeah. But as soon as he got into his bedroom, all his clothes went off. He loved his nudity.
God. I loved like Dean. You know, I'm the same way. I don't like to talk, just take my clothes off. I can relate to that, yeah. I do. I love walking around naked, and I'm that way.
I had another boyfriend that was a singer, a very famous singer, Johnny Rivers. He had lived next door to me for a while when I lived on Mulholland Drive. And very, very different. Each
Where in Mulholland
was
did you live?
So
I lived up there.
At Coldwater Canyon, Mulholland.
I was over by...
across the street from Jack Nicholson. So I got invited up to Jack Nicholson's house, and Mick Jagger was there, and Melanie Griffith, and that was interesting to meet Jack. He had his whole living room filled with beautiful gals, and then I met Marlon Brando, who lived next door to Jack, because actually I was dating his son, Christian Brando. Christian and I were very best friends, and I loved Christian, and we'd go swimming in the pool, and Marlon never put any chlorine in his swimming pool, so I'd get out of the swimming pool and I'd have spider bites all over me.
Really?
And Christian and I would sneak off into the sauna room and make wild love in the sauna room. And we'd go in his house, and Christian would... It was a beautiful, beautiful home filled with pictures of the island in Tahiti. And he'd say, look at my refrigerator. He'd open up the refrigerator, and it was just filled with this lavish display of fruit and cantaloupe. And And I'd say, yeah, you're eating all this fruit. But I say, hey, Christian, how come your dad wants you to go pick up a case of beer, you know, Chris? How come, you know, all the beer? Who needs that? And he'd go, oh, well, you know, he loved his beer. So I'm not a beer drinker. No. I'm a bottled, cold bottled water drinker.
Really?
No, no. I gave up drinking. If you want to stay, you know, keep your looks, if you want to keep your health, it's just get rid of that, get rid of the smoke, get rid of that junk, and just stay with your salads, country green salads, and your... There's no reason to have any sugar, any salt at all, I'm telling you.
Really?
John, come to my place and I'll fix you something really healthy and you'll feel re-energized and, you know, just no, a little bit of chicken now and then, you know, keep your blood sugar level up.
So,
have your...
It'd be so hard. I guess that you're right. I mean, you have to change your habits after a while.
You've got to get into, like, eating fish. You know, have your iron is in even, you know, canned sardines. There's your iron for the day. And your salmon for your calcium. And your, you know, your vitamins. Your vitamin E every day. You got to have that.
Got to have that.
And stay away from the... sex potency drugs. I don't like that whole concept of that. Those things that they're advertising, take Viagra and this Cialis, I think it's the side effects on that, I think, is where the trouble is. And people, I wish they would take that into consideration. All this.
Well, women don't have that problem. I guess it's for men mostly. I've never used it, Viagra. I've never tried it. We got about a minute. Never tried it.
Well, good. It's nice to hear that about you. And I wish you could see some of the clips from all the other films.
I wish we had time to see all the others. I mean, I was just looking at you. Look how great you look.
Well, I'm doing
blogging. They could check you out. And you know, so once again, they could find your movies all over on Amazon.
I'm in the middle of making a documentary film with a producer, Doug Miller. I met him at the Prism Awards. And it's going to be about from the beginning and... how rescuing racehorses from the track, from the birth of
they were doing that with
breeding.
The greyhounds.
Mm-hmm.
A friend of mine, I was living with Albert Anastasia's son, and then we had the greyhound. We got to wrap it up. It doesn't cost nothing to be nice. Remember, there's three things in life. There's family, making love, and the smell of gravy on a Sunday morning. Now, how can I make gravy without salt and pepper and stuff like that?
You could put it on the bodice of my cleavage, and you could taste it there.
I would love to.
Did you ever think of doing something like that?
Yes.
That's what all the people say. You're riding high in April, shot down in May. But I know I'm gonna change that.